Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Now, it's time for me and our good friend, Russell Tammany, to take a look at a crazy camera that we just bought.
Yes.
We both bought one. You first, right?
Well, we sort of, you know, these cameras are very similar, so... Let's set you up with what we started with.
Because exactly. You use a Canon One...
I have a 1DX.
1DX, which is...
I've reviewed that as well.
Very popular camera that I use, very popular with pros. This is the 5D. This is a Mark II, but they're all about the same size.
Right.
We're talking big, heavy cameras, big, heavy lenses. And the reason people go out and buy these cameras is the sensor. It's what they call a full-frame sensor, essentially the size of a 35mm.
Right. So you get a full large sensor, but the downside is that then, you've got a huge tank, and the 1DX is even larger.
Right.
And so I had the NEX 7, which I also reviewed for Before You Buy. That was like my smaller camera, mm-hmm.
There's one way really to get this much smaller, which is eliminate the mirror. If you look in digital SLRs, in fact, all SLRs traditionally have had a prism in these that acts as a mirror that allows the light from the lens to come up through into the viewfinder, and so that you can see what you're going to get a picture of. But that is a big old mirror that you have to move out of the way. So lately, we've seen a number of mirrorless solutions. Instead of having an optical prism that has to be moved up out of the way, adding to the size and the complexity of the body, these cameras now use electronic viewfinder, essentially a video tap that looks through the lens, and then you see what the camera is going to see through the viewfinder. We want to put this back on because the actual sensor in there.
That's the actual sensor.
You might want to put
I'm
your lens
dust
back on
all
there.
Over, the
you know
place.
What's worst? Somebody told me micro spittle.
Oh, yeah. Well, you don't want to get anything wet or anything oily or
greasy
in there.
Right, and spit is a little acidic, so it can actually etch the surface of your full frame. Yeah. So this is exciting. As you mentioned, the NEX, I bought an Olympus OMD, which is a Micro Four Thirds. Your NEX 7 is an APS-C sensor.
Right, it was a small sensor
but
as well.
These small cameras have, until now, except for the very, very high-end cameras, have... Like for instance,
there's been a couple of fixed full frame. Sony, was it the RX1?
And
or
what's
something
the really
like that?
What's the really expensive? One? I can always forget the name of it because I don't want to think
had
about it.
Leica,
that's it.
M8 or something.
Yeah, so they've had full frame sensors, but it's very rare in the mirrorless sphere. Then Sony, put the world in a tizzy last fall.
So Sony said we're going to put a huge sensor in our kind of mirrorless body, and nobody had done that before, and it's exciting for a lot of reasons because it means you don't have to carry around that huge camera to get a full-frame quality picture. And it's the one thing where, you know, I have a full-frame camera, and it's large, and I have to decide, is it worth bringing around the huge 5D Mark III, the 1DX, especially if you're traveling. It's just a lot more to go with.
Well, in fact,
just the battery charger for my 1DX is larger than this entire camera.
The preview versions of this is the, you have the A7, I have the A7R. We'll talk about the differences in a second. But the preview versions of these cameras were seeded out to some of the world's best-known photographers to universal raves.
There was a lot of sort of hype and a lot of, pre-ordering. I think I got my pre-order in like a day after it was announced or the same day. So
Trey Ratcliffe, very famously, who had just recently given up his full-bodied Nikon DSLRs for the Sony NEX cameras, went the next step, gave them up for this. He is now, there is a point to be made with this, that he is a landscape photographer.
Right.
But he's decided, Trey Ratcliffe has decided to do all of his shooting now with his A7R. He was using a D800. And a D800E, and this is actually the same sensor as in the Nikon D800E.
Yeah.
So I think it's an easy transition for him to make.
Yeah, and this is very similar to the D800. So you're essentially getting a cheaper version of that.
Yeah, because that's like a $3,000 or $4,000 body, right?
Yeah. So the A7, this body only retails for around $1,700, like $1,698, somewhere around there. And there's a kit version that's also available that has a 28-70 kind of zoom lens, but it also has optical stabilization. So you can get it in a kit with a lens, which is probably what most people are going to do if it's their only camera. But I'm
so
sort
it's
of
about $2,000 with the lens.
Yeah, it's about $2,000 with the lens. But I'm a fan of buying the body and then just using either my existing lenses or picking exactly what I want. I don't necessarily want what is in a kit lens.
What are the specs of that
A7? The specs on the A7 is that you get a 24.3 megapixel full frame sensor with 14-bit RAW, and so that it's already quite large. The A7R, I believe, is 36, but
yeah,
it's a little bit higher. You do get a phase detect autofocus, which is really nice in the A7 because it means that in the actual sensor, there are phase detect for high quality autofocus. So it's a little better at, you know, acquiring an accurate autofocus or continuous tracking and for things like that. Does about 5 frames a second, and you have a lot of great features. The electronic viewfinder, I had this on the NEX7, and it was a little laggy, a little kind of floaty and blurry, especially in lower light, and they've significantly improved it in the A7. And the A7R has the same viewfinder as well.
So the big difference between the A7 and the A7R is that this is 39 megapixels.
Yeah,
it's a larger, it's the same sensor, both full-frame sensors,
right,
but it's just a higher resolution. That's not necessarily a pro. You're going to get better low-light performance, for instance, on the A7.
Right, so the low-light and high ISO performance is a little bit better on the A7 than the A7R.
Yeah.
But the A7R also removes the anti-aliasing filter.
That's like the D800E.
Which is like the D800E.
And now, there's pros and cons to that. It means right. that moiré-ing is more likely, right?
Right. So with a shirt like what Leo's wearing right now, it's got a very fine kind of linen pattern.
You probably can't
it.
Even see it.
You probably can't see it on the cameras. But that's the kind of pattern that can show in certain certain environments a kind of moiré effect, which is looks sort of like a rainbow.
Yeah.
And the issue with that is that that's something that you can't really correct later in RAW easily. There are, you know, removal software and things like that, but it's something that's not as simple as a simple vignetting or distortion or
now,
another correction.
I should point out this doesn't happen that often.
Right.
You would be able to see it in the electronic
yes,
viewfinder,
and, you see it on your
and then a minor adjustment to the zoom
yeah.
or the focus would generally fix that.
The benefit is that you don't get this essentially blur filter that
it's
is placed
softening.
Over. It's a softening filter
yeah.
that's placed over the sensor. So the issue is that you're trading the phase detect sensors for the lack of an AF filter. So
that's the side effect.
So that's the side effect.
So there's two things. You no longer have the anti-moiré, and you no longer have phase detect focusing.
Well, so you lose the phase detect focusing when you do the A7R, which
this
is the
uses
one that,
peak
right,
focusing.
So that uses contrast.
Contrast,
and
yeah.
And so the regular A7 still has the phase detect, which means it should be more accurate for focusing. However, I felt it was still a little slow, and it's not the kind of thing. Either of these cameras are not going to be the kind of thing you're going to see at the Olympics for sports.
They're not very fast.
They're not very
yeah.
fast.
Now, one of the other things that people really liked about this, I'll give you a negative right up front. There are only currently two lenses available. You can use the NEX E lenses,
right,
but they're cropped because it's
right.
an APS sensor. So if you want to take advantage of the full frame sensor, don't worry. That's just an $8,000 lens. It's no big deal. If you want to use the, we'll put that up on something more stable. If you want to use other third party lenses, you can use an adapter. I have, there are a number of companies that make these. This is a Metabones adapter, about $400 adapter.
Which I have the same adapter,
it allows,
so that I can use my camera.
And they make this for a variety of lenses I'm using here. These are the same lenses I use with my Canon 5D Mark II. These
right.
are the good Canon L lenses with the adapter. What's nice about the Metabones adapter, unlike some of them, is that all the electronics still work.
Yes.
Autofocus, everything.
Autofocus,
but what's not
aperture.
So nice is it really slow.
Yes.
So slow that you almost always end up using manual focus.
Right.
And now that is one of the things that these cameras are very good at is manual focus. They have one feature is an auto zoom on the EVF that lets you see very closely.
Right.
You don't have peaking in yours,
no,
do
these
you?
Do peaking
they
as
do.
Well.
Okay.
That's the other thing. I mean, you would think, you know, if this was a Canon would limit the features and firmware of what is in the A7 compared to the A7R, because it's just sort of what they do when
right.
you look at the different lineups of Canon.
That does everything
this
that
does
the R
everything
does.
That the R does. So, it
so
has
peaking is nice.
The,
so
the peaking. Let me,
it'll show you where it's focused and it'll light up
right,
where it's
so
peak
what it,
focused.
So what it does is, if you haven't seen it before, is it highlights high contrast edges. So it's sort of like running a edge detection and a contrast detection. And it will, along the trim, so like you would see, if you were looking at me through this sort of peaking filter, as you were manually focusing forward and back, you would see that the most in focus is going to have little peaking along all the contrast
it's kinda cool.
areas. You'll have little like ridges of the color that you choose, and you can choose white, red, or yellow.
The point being, and I don't want to get too much into the weeds on the pros and cons. I think we should start talking about how we use it. But the point being, Manual focus is actually a very relatively easy thing to do in here.
And I've gone from using autofocus all the time on the back button AF on my 1D and my 5Ds to, for the last couple trips I took the A7 on, 99% manual focus.
Not so great on horse races or lacrosse tournaments.
But for what I was doing, it was actually really nice.
That's my point. One of the reasons a person like Trey Ratcliffe really likes this camera is he's doing landscapes.
Yeah.
And if you're using a tripod and you don't have to, if you're not shooting birds in flight, you don't have to, the autofocus is a little slow even on using the actual
native lenses,
the so-called FE lenses, full-frame E lenses. So I guess the point I would make is there's only two native lenses now. They're good. This is probably the best of them. This is a 55mm 1.8. Right. There's also a
28.18.
There's
a
28-35 zoom. And then
There's a couple that's available now. There's 12 in the roadmap, and there's two or three that are coming out in the next couple months.
The roadmap going to the end of next
year.
But they are promising a lot of lenses.
I've got a lens on.
Here's the first thing I would say is, while a lot of people, including Trey, talk about using adapters and using their beautiful Leica lenses on this thing, be aware that you're probably going to be doing manual focus. It's going to be like you do with a Leica. It's going to be a little bit finicky, a little bit fussy.
And
it's for somebody who's willing to take the time. I've decided it's just too much work for me. I'm going to use the stock lens on this.
If you see side by side,
it also has significantly
the bulk. You have the Metabones adapter on it.
Yeah.
It has to push, essentially the lens out. Right. So you end up with this huge lens. And what's happening is that you can't simply mount a lens that was designed for a system with a mirror box directly to a mirrorless camera. And that's why you have to stage it out, because you would lose your infinity focus. So if you were able to somehow tape the lens directly onto the camera, you would not have the ability to focus anything.
Having
anymore.
Said that, so the combination of the Zeiss lens is a very good, this 55mm is the one I'd recommend, with this body, makes a very compact, very nice shooter. I mean, the full frame, really, you notice it. It's very good. But it's finicky.
Well, they went with this retro design, right?
So I like the design. I know my all the dials.
It went a little retro, and they decided they did some good things. Like, they got rid of the NEX 7 kind of consumer menu, and they went to a more professional menu system that would be what you find on the regular Sony Alphas. It's very similar to Nikon and Canon menus. But they made some decisions with the body and handling where, the shutter button is right on top of the on-off switch, and it's in a very traditional location if you're on a film like an F-series Nikon film camera. However, it's always a little awkward. You hold the camera now, and you want in your grip, that's where your shutter is. But instead, it's up here. You have to reach around and sort of change the placement from what's natural.
There have been some legitimate
couple little dials, and
there have been some legitimate complaints about the ergonomics. Some of the buttons are hard to reach.
And the electronic viewfinder, as good as it is, has an automatic sensor
that decides
you want to look through the viewfinder. You want to look at the screen on
the
back.
Well, when you put your eye up to it, the default would be, of course, the LCD. Right. And it's a very, very good high-resolution LCD. But then when I put my eye up to the sensor, it will switch to the sensor.
Right. And you
can have a hard time? You find that not?
If you turn that around and
you're going to accidentally
show it to the camera. Anytime we have studio lights, so it's a little harder. But
I'm doing it just with my finger. Yeah,
you can just sort of cover it. And so what happens is, if you're trying to shoot low, you got the tilt LCD.
I like that too.
And so if you're trying to shoot low, if you're trying to shoot in and tight and do some work like this, it'll keep blinking off, especially in dark conditions.
And there's no manual button.
There is a manual button, but it takes you to the menu, which then forces you to scroll through the menu to select between auto and But it's that sort of Sony thing where everything is buried in the menu settings, and
so let's
you can set it up, but
there's a lot to be said, and I don't want to spend an hour on this.
Yeah, so photo stuff, it all really works exactly as you expect. It takes fantastic raw photos.
JPEGs, according to DP Review, have been very poor.
I don't ever shoot
JPEGs, so
I never
set
my stuff to JPEG in the first place.
Don't buy this to shoot JPEGs.
These are some photos that I shot. I've had the camera for a couple months, and I took it to San Antonio. I took it to Puerto Rico and to Paris, and so it's been my travel camera now. And I've always had regrets when I bring my NEX, when I bring point and shoot, even the NEX, it's not as good.
Right.
And you don't have the depth of field. You don't
look at
the
depth of field here. It's really nice.
It's really fantastic. So I can honestly say that I was able to go and use the camera and not think about, you know, you think about some of the little issues, but you don't think, I wish I had my 1DX. I wish I had a 5D Mark III. I can't take this picture without it.
The quality is superb.
And so not having, you know, having that. That being said, the video features, I don't have a video to show. However, this checks every single box that you would really want to have for video on a DSLR.
Yeah.
And so...
External microphone capability.
Yeah. So you get external microphone, you get headphones, you get audio levels.
You can actually see meters on the screen,
which is missing from a lot. Mm-hmm. You also get, which is super important, clean 1080p video output, which means it's uncompressed. You can use a Blackmagic recorder. You can use an Atomos from or a Atomos Ninja or Samurai or something like that. Key Pro. You can basically get extremely high quality video directly out of the camera. And you know, it will also do, you know, all the regular higher compression settings, like in camera you can get your MPEG-4, you can get high bit rate, like 28 something megabit MPEG-4. And the video looks really good, but when you look at the uncompressed video out, it's sort of like the difference between the Blackmagic cinema cameras and, you know, a regular point and shoot type video. So
it's really good.
It's really good. And it doesn't have the full bit depth that the Blackmagic cinema camera has, but if you have the exposure right, you can get really good results from the video.
So let's wrap it up on the pros and cons. And I have a feeling we're going to agree pretty much on the pros and cons. So the pros, excellent image quality, excellent video quality. I guess you could say a pro, the fact that you could use a broad variety of lenses with this.
The third-party lens adapters, you can adapt everything to this because it has the shallowest registration distance. So every single other type of lens is capable of being adapted to it.
But that leads us to one of the negatives, which is
no Sony lenses.
There are very few actual manufacturers' Zeiss lenses.
Right.
And the other lenses tend to be very slow.
Right.
I'll give you another negative that is not on your A7, but is on the A7R, is the shutter. And a number of people complain.
See, I've never heard that shutter.
So this is, if you listen, the shutter sound, there's a two-click sound. Right. That's one picture. And some have noted that it actually is such a big physical click, because there is a physical thing going on, that it might jiggle the camera a little bit.
Right.
And yours, let's hear yours.
So this is on the A7, and it just has a single, it has a digital first curtain. So,
when you
hear that, okay, that's the end. That's the second curtain. So essentially what your camera is doing is it's got to bring down in front of the sensor a physical shutter, start the exposure, pull it, and then put it back.
Yeah.
And so that's why you get that second curve.
That gives you some flexibility, but it also jiggles the camera quite a bit.
It also makes the response time slower.
It really feels slow.
So I've found, kind of just running around shooting with the A7, that it really responds extremely quickly, and, you know, it just feels really nice that way. It does have a long startup time, which I'm assuming the A7R does.
Yeah, this also
does
really long.
Which is a little frustrating.
And you can't shoot very fast with it.
Yeah,
you got me beat.
and I'm in continuous, and like...
So, and that brings up another one that is a little bit more subtle, which is that if you put this in program mode or aperture mode, it's going to want to go to 1/60th.
Right.
And that is actually too slow for this lens and this click.
Right.
And that is a software that they could fix.
Right.
But what happens is it's adjusting the ISO for trying to get to 1/60th.
Right.
It should really be trying to get to 1/125th or better.
And that's the thing, is I've seen a lot
of
complaints.
Does yours do that also?
Yes. And I've seen a lot of complaints about little nitpicky things about like that with the 1/60th. And it is important, but if you're aware of it, it just means, you know, I'm used to using the manual modes. I don't like auto ISO.
I like aperture priority, and you don't use aperture priority. You tend to use shutter priority so that you can force a faster shutter speed.
So
that's
just
a little bit of a disadvantage for me, because I like aperture priority. But it's something to be aware of.
Right.
It's a negative. You're right. It's nitpicky.
There's negatives, but the big nitpick is that I'm not confident that Sony will fix it.
Right.
Because I've had the NEX7. There's been multiple little issues like that, and none of them were fixed in the firmware. So
this is, and this seems to be a very common thing now.
Yes.
We're seeing a lot of what I call diva cameras. They are amazing. The performance is incredible, but it comes at a bit of finickiness and trouble. And I think for a lot of people, the frustrations might outweigh the benefits.
Right.
If you're looking for a really great full-frame camera that is light and compact, gives you great images, and you're willing to put up with some of these little quibbles we've talked about,
right.
I think this is definitely a buy. The second negative is it's fairly pricey, although if you compare it to a D800, it's a good deal. You were going to show, I know, the Sony wireless capability.
Right.
All the Sony cameras now have this.
All the Sony cameras have the same. So they finally added Wi-Fi and NFC, and you can just do the old...
He's going to pair his phone.
Put the phone next to it.
That's a nice feature.
The Play Memories app will launch. And you've got remote shooting. You've got...
So you can trigger the camera from the phone.
You can trigger the camera from the phone.
You can copy pictures to the camera.
Yes, and you get a preview every time you take it. So if it's set up on a tripod, you can, you know, get it. And
the other wild thing is, because there's Wi-Fi, I can join our Wi-Fi network, and without leaving the camera, share to Flickr and Facebook.
Right, so you get a live view of
that's
what the camera sees.
That's kind of great. But I don't even need to do that. I can actually, from the camera.
Yeah.
It also has apps. The App Store isn't huge yet. There's a time-lapse app that's good, but it's $10. You know,
so
I don't know. Are you going to give it a try, a buy, a don't? Buy.
So I'm going to give it a buy. However, I'm still a little hesitant to recommend it if this is like your only camera, your first camera. And the reason is that you really have a lot more flexibility. If you can deal with the slightly larger body size and the actual, you know, mirror box, you were probably better off with a D800, D600, or Canon 5D Mark III or something like that. And the traditional lens lineup, you have a lot more flexibility if it's going to be your only camera. And you should know how amazing it is to use a optical viewfinder.
Right.
But all that said, this is the best mirrorless camera I have used, and I've been very happy with it and have no regrets taking it on any trips or, you know, missing full frame cameras. So it's a buy, you know, with those kind of, you know, you want to wait for the lenses. Sony's got a 24-70 f/4 OSS Zeiss lens, it's going to be fantastic. A couple other lenses will be great, but they're not out now, and you know how it is. You wait 6 months, 8 months, maybe there'll be an A7 R Mark II. So.
Yeah, that's why I'm going to say don't buy the A7 R. You'd be better off with a D800 if you want, D800E if you want no anti-aliasing, a 5D Mark II if you really want a fast through the lens camera. This is a really interesting camera.
But you still get the weather sealing on these, so
it's weather sealing.
I've got this thing really wet in a waterfall.
We could go back and forth. I think you've heard enough, though, to know whether it's right for you.
Yeah.
A don't buy from me, a buy from Russell. We really agree more than that would tell you. I just think that you should probably wait for the next generation.
And I have to say that if you look between the A7R and the A7, that the A7 is a stronger buy for the price.
That's probably true.
And for the almost similar quality
that you
get.
That's right.
As well.
I'd agree with you. Yep.